All right, guys, welcome. You should have just finished doing all of your wins, and congratulations on that. You know, celebrating your wins is a big part of not only getting free from your past, but of really locking yourself into what's happening now and moving into the great future God has for you, because you're retraining your brain and your emotions to be excited about your victories instead of focusing so much on your failures. And the more excited you are about your victories, the more you focus on them, the more that you actually physiologically, your body, your brain will want that again, and it'll actually help push you towards making better decisions because it wants to feel the feeling of success again. So celebrate, celebrate all the time. Even if you've had failures, focus on something that you won and then find a way to celebrate it. That's okay to do, and it's gonna help you. We're gonna jump into today's topic, and it's I am the power of identity. And so what is your identity? That's a good question. What would you say your identity is? We don't start L3 by standing up and saying, "Hi, my name is Jim and I'm an alcoholic." Why? Because that is an identity statement. And we don't believe that. Maybe you've come from AA or one of those other groups. Maybe you still go. And I'm not trying to throw shade on any groups, but I'm saying here at L3, we don't do that. Why? Because we want to focus on the identity that we actually want to walk in now and who we are now. So, how do we do that? Well, there's a great QR code on your sheet, and you can watch this video. Either as a whole group or watch it on your own. And Johnny Cash was a famous country singer, one of the greatest of all time, and he had a great song where a guy tells a story throughout the song. He sings it out, where a guy was working at an auto factory and he wanted a car there. It was a Cadillac factory, and he couldn't afford one. So, what he did in the song, as you listen to the whole thing go through, every day as he went home from work, he stole one part. He stole a bolt, he stole a handle, he stole a steering wheel, he stole a mirror. He would just steal one part a day. And he worked there for decades. And then every time he'd take a part home, he'd add it to the car. And so by the time he actually got done building this car, the car spanned decades because he would bring a part home in 1969 and then bring a part home. Still, he was doing that in 1970 and 71, 72, 73. So by the time he gets done, he has this car that's got a mixed match mess of all these different parts. And he gets in that thing, and he's driving it down the road, and he's singing, "I've got a 69, 70, 71, 72." And he's singing through the whole name of this year, make, model of his car because it's this whole hodgepodge of things that have been thrown together over time. Well, do you know what? That's a lot like we live our lives sometimes. We hold our identity as all of these different things that have happened throughout our life. And so rather than being who you are right now, you're like, "Well, I'm an addict and I'm an abuse victim and I'm a thief. I've stole before and I'm flunked out of high school," or, you know, "I was a college graduate and top of my class and then I lost a loved one." And like we put all these pieces together. And then that becomes our identity. And it can feel very disjointing. It can feel very chaotic, even our own emotions and our own mind on who am I right now? Who am I today? Well, that's what we want to talk about. And here's a way that the world identifies people. Because there's many ways that you can be identified: experiences, hurts, habits, hang-ups, desires, the things that you desire, what your dreams are. But here's the way that the world pieces these together. They'll identify you based on your political views. "Oh, I know them, they're a right winger. Oh, I know them, they're a loony leftist." Whatever the case of where you would fall, but they'll label you right away as soon as they hear anything about your politics. Bam, I know who that person is. That's their identity. Or your financial status. "I can tell by how you're dressed, you're not somebody that I want to talk to because you don't have the money." Or, "I can tell by the way you're dressed, you're not somebody I'd want to talk to because you have too much money. I know what those rich people are like." It works on both sides. But we can identify based on financial status, career paths. Somebody says, "Oh, how are you? Oh, yeah, my name's Jim. I'm a doctor." And people will just throw out who they, you ask them anything about themselves, and they'll just throw out what they do because their career is their identity. Not, "I'm a father, you know, I'm a husband," or, you know, "I'm a fisherman." Like they'll start out with, like, "This is my, yeah, I'm a construction worker, I'm a painter, I'm a nurse." Whatever the case is of what they do, they'll throw that out there, and that's one of the ways that people identify themselves. also by their personal accomplishments. They'll talk about things that they've done, things that they've achieved, and that's their identity, and you hold on to that, like, you know, I did this once, I accomplished this before, I ran the fastest race, I got a promotion, I have a hit song, I'm a great YouTuber, and I've got people that are following me, and I have a video that I put out, and it got a bunch of likes, or it went viral, or whatever that thing is, like, this is what I've accomplished. People can do it on things that sound spiritual and amazing, but it's the same. Their identity is what they've accomplished. Oh, I've helped a lot of people. Oh, I've served a lot of homeless. They'll throw out the things that they do as their identity. Well, that sounds great in some cases, but what happens if something happens in your life that doesn't allow you to do that anymore? Where did your identity go? Those great athletes that achieved all the things, suddenly they retire or they blow their knee out and they can no longer play. And guess what happens? They have an identity crisis. Sometimes people getting out of the military have an identity crisis, or coming out of a long-term career. Parents, kids move out of the house and they're empty nesters, and all of a sudden they've lost their identity. Because their identity was in what they were doing. And when something changes what they can do, it also takes away their identity. And that can be very dangerous. Past mistakes. People can identify their past mistakes. You know, I'm an alcoholic. You know, well, I'm a drug addict. You know, I was abused, or I'm an abuser. You know, I have a record. But they'll look at the things from the past, and they'll make their identity based off of that. Also, their relational status can be a big identity maker. And well, I'm married. You know, I'm single. You know, I'm divorced. Oh, I'm a widow. I'm a mom, I'm a dad, I'm a child. I mean, name any of these things, but my identity is based on what my relational status is. And that's something that's very common in our culture. One that's very big in our culture also is being identified by your sexual desires. So this isn't just something I desire, but this is my identity. I'm heterosexual, I'm gay, I'm bisexual, I'm whatever the case is, but it's identified based off of a desire. And that tells me who I actually am, not just something that I want or something that I feel drawn to, but it's who I am. And that's the statement that people make. There's right now, currently, as I made this video, 73 gender identities, not just male and female. There's 73, and you can find those on Medical News Today. There's a list of those, and I put the link here on the sheet. And that will change. By the time you watch this video, there might be 173. But 73 gender identities, what does that even mean? I don't think anybody really knows what it means. But it's a way of people identifying themselves. Why? Because people want to be known. You look at that first and say, oh, that's a bunch of weirdness and craziness. But why are people doing that? Why are people breaking things down into such minute detail on how they want to be identified? Because they want someone to see them and to see them as unique and to say, this is who I am. God wants us to have an identity, but he wants our identity to be based on the right things. And so we're going to keep looking at this. Body types is another one. Size, shape, color, ability, gender. I mean, all these things. What's your body type? Well, I'm a big, strong guy. I'm a big, strong gal. I'm just a little wimp. Or I'm petite, you know, or I'm slender and lean. I mean, we have these ideas of this is who I am based on the body type. And that can tell you about somebody, oh, they look athletic. And, you know, they actually may not even be into sports at all, or they may not be athletic, but they got the look. They look like an athlete. You know, I'm bald, so people ask me all the time if I'm military. I'm like, nope, I'm just a guy that can't grow hair, but I'm not military. So if I'm checking out at a hardware store by my house, or sometimes at a restaurant or wherever, they'll go to ring up my thing, they'll look at me and they go, oh, a military discount? And I'm like, nope, not military. But God bless the ones that serve, but that's not me. But I could have my identity based on my body type, and other people will try to label me based on what they think they see. But that is not who I am. So what does make who I am? Well, I want to ask you that. If you've ever heard of Picasso, he's a famous artist and painter, and people can look at a painting, and just by the way that it looks, they can go, oh, that's a Picasso. Or like that's a Picasso, I can tell. Because there's a certain style and a certain way that he painted. And so the goal, the ultimate, is to be known not for who you are, but to be known by who made you. That is where true peace comes from and wholeness comes from, is that somebody looks at you and goes, wow, you know what? They were made by God. And if you can rest in the fact that, you know what, my value and my identity doesn't come in any of these other categories. Ultimately, my value and my identity comes because I was made by a great creator. I'm his masterpiece. I'm his artwork. David said that we are fearfully and wonderfully made, that God made us. So regardless of where you fall in any of these categories, your value comes from being made by the creator of heaven and earth, who chose to make you, chose to design you. And the more science catches up to biblical truth, the more this is proven. Because they can now show that everything about your hair color, your height, your body type, even your intelligence level. Now there's some room in there to work on learning and growing and all those types of things. But the general person that you are right now is actually already designed in your DNA before you're born. The Bible talks about that too. It says that we were knit together in our mother's womb, that God literally made us, and DNA looks just like a strand of thread that God's knitted together. God wanted you to be you. And you can rest in knowing that you have an identity in God, and everything else is getting worked out, but your value has already been settled. So take some time to journal on whatever's stirring up in your heart and on your mind, and just let God speak to you as you journal for a minute. You can journal in words, you can doodle, write pictures, whatever lets you express through your mind and then down to a pen and onto paper the feelings that you're having, the thoughts that you're having. Write that stuff down, and then after that, break out into discussion groups and talk about this. And I believe that God's going to help you to have a great night and to have some breakthroughs. And I pray that God will bring value to each and every one of you, and that you can begin to live out of the value that he's already put there.